The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Friends, I want to welcome you to Christ Presbyterian Church today. We're so glad you're joining us, those here in the sanctuary, those joining us online at home. We're so thrilled you're with us. Today is the second week of our soft opening. And if you're new to this, what we have done last week and this week is that we are doing a limited soft opening in preparation for our return to normal worship hours next week on June 21st at 10:30. And so last week and this week, we've been meeting 4 o'clock Saturdays to record and inviting people as they feel comfortable to attend. And we think that that's part of this whole sort of recovery for our area, our country, as people start to feel more comfortable. We see businesses and restaurants opening. I just saw in the paper today, the parks are opening. That people have to start to feel comfortable and establish their own comfort levels. And so we've done these 2 weeks of soft opening that can't see it on the camera, but we have a wonderful crowd here. And next week, 10:30, as normal. But there will be some changes because we will be trying to adhere by recommendations to safeguard folks. A couple of those things, unfortunately, we're not having refreshments, at least not for the near future. So if you're really, if you would have coffee by an IV, if that's how much you love your coffee, bring it with you. Bring it with you. Bring it in here with you. That's okay. If you need a snack, bring it with you here too. Bring something to share with me as well. We won't pass the offering plates. Instead, there are receptacles at the corners of the sanctuary, and we also will not be passing the peace. Coming in the future, until we feel we've established a level of where we feel things are under control, we'll also be doing communion in a different way, actually having portable individual communion sets for people, which we will take up in July. So there'll be a little bit of changes. I mean, the basic structure of worship will be the same, but things to help people feel more comfortable. So that is next week. We begin our regular opening at 10:30 on Sunday. Leading up to that, we will have masks and even gloves and hand sanitizer. And we've had folks who've donated masks. Karen Alford, for example, has sewn a bunch of masks and, in fact, have a baggie full here of adults and even children's sizes. So Tim Burberry back there, that's from Karen, one of Karen's, and we also have others there. This was sewn for me. I love this mask. It has Bible verses on it, so it's really beautiful, and I thank Tina for sewing that for me. So if you have a need, we will do our best to meet it. Also wanted to share with you kind of a help wanted. This whole thing, and remember, if you think about it, we have not met in person since March, which is a really long time, but it's kind of thrown off our schedule. We're not sure who feels comfortable, who doesn't feel comfortable, and so our regular liturgist, folks who volunteer, we're not sure who feels, all right coming or not. If you'd ever wanted to serve as a liturgist before, we'd love to have you come. It's actually a little bit scaled down now. We're also looking for people to help with Jesse's children, and we do need, this is a big need, we need somebody or multiple people to train with Patrick to run the camera and the filming system. It's Patrick, it's really easy, right?
Oh, incredibly easy.
Incredibly easy. Right, and the deal with Patrick is he can't go on vacation this year until we get a substitute. So he's desperate, folks, he's desperate. So it's really easy. And everybody, I've had people say they don't like to be an upfront person. Well, this is a way to be a behind the scenes person, which is just as important. Also want to share with you that the Baby Bottles of Blessings for New Beginning, what we decided at staff meeting, we thought, again, not everybody will probably come back at the same rate. Just bring your bottle when you're here. I'm on the board of New Beginning. We had our first board meeting since January, and we talked about that. And of course, this has been their biggest fundraiser. This is how they run their budget, and it's really taken a hit this year. So if you have your baby bottles, bring them in. We'll collect them and we'll bring them down individually. You can see other announcements on the bulletin. I know the Men's Weekly Fellowship is gathering again. Monty, you gather on Saturday mornings. Monty. Paying attention? Okay, yeah. And you're meeting where, Monty?
At the market, down on
Third Avenue at the market. So that's 8:30 at the market. So if you'd like to meet there with Monty and some of the gentlemen, just a time for Christian gentlemen to get together and fellowship together. And again, we're glad you're joining us with us today. I want to invite you now to join us here and wherever you are watching the service in our call to worship. I'd ask you to stand. From the word of the Lord in Romans chapter 8, the scripture says, "Therefore,
there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. Amen. Our first hymn this morning is Come Christians, Join to Sing, led by the Lamp family.
To be named for our greatest character fault. Hi, I'm greedy. Hi, I'm gossip. What would your name be or my name be? Bitter? Angry? Anxious? Uncontrollable temper? Lustful? Afraid? Selfish? We will never be able to change until we openly, honestly, and authentically admit our sin, our weakness, our faults, our frailty, and our character defects, and confess this to ourselves, to God, and to other people. Yes, James 5:16 says, believers are to confess to and pray for one another. When you come to God and say, God, I want to own up to the weaknesses and the wrong in my life. This is who I really am. God's not going to be surprised. He already knows, but he needs us to confess so the work of change can begin. God's forgiveness and grace is bigger than anything wrong we've ever done or will do. Let us come before him, first silently in our personal confession, and then corporately as we confess before God and each other. Let us pray. And together. Heavenly Father, we confess that the stresses and anxieties of life often weigh us down and take our attention away from you. The joy which should be ours is forfeited when we fret and start approaching challenges by relying on our strength instead of on yours, which never fails. We are all too prone to forget who you are, O God. And that is our biggest failing, for we were made by you and for you. So we pray now for forgiveness through Jesus Christ, your Son. Help us to find strength in him who truly lived in perfect attention and fellowship with you. And let us not only imitate his example, but through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, renew us in body, soul, and spirit, that we may have the same mind as Christ, always fixed on you, even as our anxieties try to distract and distance us from your salvation, found in him alone, Jesus, our Lord and Redeemer. Amen. Jesus is the one Lord you can live for, who died for you, who knew you, who had your name and my name on his lips as he breathed his last breath. Jesus is the only Lord who will fulfill you completely and forgive you eternally. 1 John 2, verses 1 and 2 says, "If anybody does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defense, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world." Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. And now we welcome Jane Nicholas, who's going to bring us Jesse's Children.
On another parable of Jesus, and I thought we should just act it out. So, Jesus had been invited to the meal of the home of a prominent Pharisee for a meal. And while he was there, he noticed that the guests chose for themselves the places of honor around the table. So Jesus told them this parable. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not sit in the place of honor. For someone more distinguished than you may have also been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come to you and say, "This seat was intended for this person. Please move." Then you will have to move down to the least important place. Now, how do you think she was feeling? Maybe a little silly for having taken the place of honor? Maybe embarrassed? You can go back to your original spots. In the scripture, it's translated that actually the person was humiliated in front of all the other wedding guests. No, ladies, you're still here. So instead, Jesus continued, when you are invited to the feast, choose for yourself the lowest place to sit, so that then the host will come to you and will say, "Friend, please move up to a better place." And then you will be honored in the presence of all your fellow guests. Then Jesus ended his parable like this. He said, "For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted." See, through this parable, Jesus was teaching us about pride and humility. And I know that for the children, it can be very confusing sometimes because we hear people use the word pride, like it's a good thing. For example, I suspect there are many in our congregation who would say that they are proud to be a son or daughter of Marshall. What do you think? Yes? Okay. Or the children, you may hear your parents and grandparents speak of you saying how proud they are of you and all your accomplishments. So it sounds like pride is a good thing, but not in Scripture. In the Bible, pride refers to the sin of trying to exalt oneself above everything and everyone else, including God and other people. Pride is what got Satan kicked out of heaven because he wanted to raise his throne above the throne of the Almighty. Pride is also the sin that Satan teased out of the hearts of Adam and Eve in the garden. In our youth Sunday school class, we have made the point over and over again that selfishness and pride are what? The root cause of all sin and evil. That selfishness and pride are the root cause of all sin and evil. But you know, pride can wear different masks. Sometimes it's easy to spot, and sometimes it's not. But what I think it boils all down to is this: where is your focus? What are you focused on? Who are you focused on? Are you focused on self, or is your focus on God and others? You know, so sometimes we humans wear the mask of pride by focusing on how wonderful we are, right? Attitudes like, I'm so smart. I'm really charming, don't you think? Of course, everyone should love me, and you know I'm pretty much right about everything. And I can do anything as long as I just follow my inner star, right? That attitude, the boastful mask of pride, is pretty easy to spot in others. Sometimes it's less easy to spot in the person in the mirror. But sometimes we humans wear the mask of pride, focusing on how awful we are. Thoughts like, oh, woe is me. I'm so dumb. Oh, I am just ugly. Do you see that blemish right there? My problems are just too big. And if you knew me, you would understand I'm a weakling and can't handle them. And nobody, not even God, could really love me. Well, although that sounds a little different than the boastful kind of pride, it's still pride because where is the focus? The focus is still on self. Jesus taught at the end of this parable that the true opposite of pride is not low self-esteem, it's humility. And humility means having our focus not on self, but on God and other people. And Jesus, of course, is our best example of living with humility. He was continually focused on his heavenly Father, doing his Father's will and bringing his Father glory. He was also continually focused on the good of others, even when it cost him great suffering. So let's close with a prayer that shifts our focus from self to God and others. Will you pray with me? Lord, you are so beautiful and you are so good. We can't even come into your presence, Lord, the presence of your holiness, except that we are covered by the grace of Christ, redeemed by his blood to be your sons and daughters. Lord, your almighty strength is greater than any of our problems, including all of the evils in our world, like racism and hate. Lord, we see evidence of your loving kindness surrounding us every day. Help us every day to surrender our pride and to take up Christ's humility. Amen. Thank you. Thank you to the children. And thank you to the cast.
Well, thank you, Jane. You know, typical as it is with Jane or really anybody who does our children's times, I probably could just say amen, take an offering, pray, and we could go home because you've really summed up, you know, the parable and the message well. But I've prepared, so as long as I've prepared, let's go for it. And thanks to all our cast members, especially Laura. Laura was getting ready in the back there. She just wasn't dressed up for this year. She's going to her prom now. Or in a little bit, and she took the ACT this morning, so that's dedication, ACT prom, and has church in the middle of it all, and participates in church. So if you ever think you're too busy, think about that young lady. But we've been looking at some parables during this time, and this will be the last week of our parables. It's been kind of an informal little short series. Next week, the 21st, for our reopening, we're going to start a very short series on the book of Philemon, because I think it has some interesting things to say to us in our current contemporary situation about how we live and treat one another. But that'll be next week, a three-part series on Philemon. And then on the 19th of July, we will actually be meeting outdoors at Barbersville Park for an outdoor worship service. Want to kind of keep things fun and light through the summer. But today we're looking at the final parable, and as Jane had explained, this is a parable that happens at a banquet, and Jesus has an important lesson, but it's not really about where you sit, but it's about the attitude that governs the heart. When I was a little boy growing up, we would go and spend a lot of time at my grandparents' house, my maternal grandparents. I was very close to them. They were very wonderful people. And we had places where we always sat. My grandfather was at the head of the table, and I always sat next to him. I was the oldest grandchild. I was the oldest child, the oldest grandchild. I was the first in everything in my family, on both sides of the family, paternal and maternal. And I always sat there, always did. And if one of my little brothers tried to be an interloper and take my place, let me tell you, I would have been really angry if I got there and they sat in my seat, because that's my seat. And I gauge my relative worth and importance by how close I am to Papa. You know, my grandfather, so we kind of get that. Jesus, again, isn't talking about social etiquette here. Social etiquette is fine. It's not the gospel. Jesus is talking, again, about those attitudes that govern us. And the background, and we'll talk a little about it after, the background is Jesus is at the house of a Pharisee, a prominent Pharisee, and that's really important because Jesus dines with Pharisees on other occasions, but in Luke's gospel, this is the only time I found the word prominent used when describing a Pharisee. It's actually, the ESV translates it very well, a chief ruler of the Pharisees. Now, if you're a prominent Pharisee, if you're a prominent anything, who's going to be invited to your party? Other people of prominence, right? I mean, it's going to be, that's, you know, birds of a feather are going to, you know, kind of flock together like that. And so, Jesus is finding himself in a situation where not only is he dealing with kind of a head honcho guy, but a lot of the other underlings, only they're pretty high up too, and they're all kind of jockeying for position. You know, who you're next to, who you associate with establishes your worth. And Jesus tells him this parable, and again, as Jane had shared with us, that's saying that there's something else that's important. It's not where you sit, but what governs your heart. So we're going to pick up in verse 7 of Luke 14. Friends, hear the word of the Lord. It said, when he noticed how the guests picked the places of honor at the table, he told them this parable. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor. For a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, give this man your seat. Then humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he will say to you, friend, move up to a better place, then you will be honored in the presence of all your fellow guests. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Then Jesus said to his host, when you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or relatives, or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? Father God, we thank you for your holy word. We thank you for the living word, our Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray now, Lord God, that the words of my mouth and meditations of all our hearts would be pure and acceptable in your sight, our Lord, our rock, and our Redeemer. In the most holy name of Jesus, we pray and give thanks. Amen. Well, there was a minister and a priest and a rabbi who were having coffee together one day, and as they were visiting, they good-naturedly began joking and boasting among themselves at who was better at their respective jobs. And so they started comparing budgets and sizes of the congregations and the number of programs they offered, and finally they decided to put it to a test by having them each go out into the woods and find a bear and try to convert it. That would determine who was best at their job. Well, when they got back together the next week, the priest said, you know, I went out and when I found a bear, I read to him from the catechism. Then I sprinkled him with holy water. Next week is his first communion. That's pretty impressive, the minister said. But I found a bear by the stream. And when I found him, I preached God's holy word to him. And the bear was so convicted, he let me baptize him right then and there. At that point, they turned to the rabbi, who was sitting there covered from head to toe in a body cast with scratches and contusions all over his body. And the rabbi said, well, looking back now, maybe I shouldn't have started with the circumcision. So that's an oldie but a goodie. But you know, it speaks of a certain truth. When we set ourselves up as top dog, there's often an unpleasant surprise waiting there for us, isn't there? You know, I remember in college once expecting to receive one of our school's top awards. It was called the R.W. George Award in psychology, and it was an honor I thought I was a shoo-in to win. In fact, folks had been telling me since my sophomore year how one day I would get that award, and as the day of the ceremony rolled around, I practically had that cash prize that came with the award. I already had it spent in my mind. Because I'd worked hard, I had a great GPA, I was graduating with honors, near the top of my class. In my mind, nobody else could get that award but me. But somebody else did. And the embarrassment I felt not getting it was probably greater than the satisfaction I think I would have had I actually won it. Well, you know, Jesus warns us about setting ourselves up like that, but you know, we need to be really clear about what he's actually saying. See, Jesus isn't just offering sage advice. This isn't like practical wisdom about not aiming too high and being disappointed because we come up short. That's not what he's saying. Rather, he's talking about the posture of our hearts, what drives us, what motivates us, and how that all figures into the kingdom of God. Now, as we mentioned, the setting of today's parable it's really important for understanding the story. Jesus is the dinner guest at the home of a prominent Pharisee. And in fact, according to N.T. Wright, Luke's gospel here has more mealtime scenes with Jesus than any of the other gospels. And surprisingly, Jesus was not adverse to sitting down with Pharisees for a meal, even though they were typically his biggest critics. But Jesus accepts the invitation, even though it quickly becomes apparent that really all they're trying to do is set him up. You see, the Pharisee who invites him, this chief ruler of the Pharisees, he isn't really doing it to be nice or to show some hospitality, but because they hope to catch Jesus in some sort of, you know, violation of the Mosaic law, which they could then use to discredit him. And so prior to our reading today, it says this. It says, one Sabbath when Jesus went out to eat in the home of a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched, and which is our first clue that everything isn't on the up and up. There in front of him was a man suffering from dropsy, which is edema, which is kind of a swelling of fluids in the soft tissues. Jesus asked the Pharisees and experts in the law, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not? But they remained silent, so taking hold of the man, he healed him and sent him away. Now, make no mistake about this, the guy that needed healing, he wasn't there that day by accident. is actually being used as a stooge by the Pharisees to see if Jesus, if they can entice him to heal on the Sabbath day and then give them the ammunition they need to accuse him that he didn't care about the law, that he flouted the Mosaic law. And of course, to the Pharisees, the law was everything. But Jesus shuts them down when he points to the heart of the law, asking whether it was permissible to heal on the Sabbath. And of course, you don't have to be a biblical scholar to know the answer to that one. It's always lawful to do good on the Sabbath. So that's how the party starts out. But as dinner's being served and everybody starts scrambling for the best seats around the table, Jesus sees another opportunity to share with them an important truth about the kingdom of God. You know, it reminds me some ways. A number of years ago, Monty will remember this. A bunch of us from church were on a mission trip to Peru. And among us that year was Patrick Hagen, who on the flight down, Patrick found himself assigned to a really cool seat near one of the bulkheads. I got to describe the seat. This seat was like its own little compartment all by itself. It kind of was up on a little platform. It had a sort of its own little roof that curved down. It was separate all by itself, and it really looked cozy. I mean, I was envious, but it was good for Patrick since he's quite tall, and it gave him some extra leg room to stretch out. So we settle all into our seats, Patrick in his nice little personal compartment, and me stuffed like a sardine back with everybody else. But at some point in the trip, I got up to stretch my legs and thought I'd go and talk to Patrick. And when I got to where he was sitting, he was gone. Now, when I say gone, I don't mean it's just like maybe he was in the bathroom or something. It's like he had never been there. All his belongings were gone. There was not a trace. There was not even a crumpled up napkin on the tray table. Vanished. 30,000 feet in the air like he never existed. And I was stumped. I'm thinking, well, I know he didn't get off somewhere, you know, but I couldn't figure out what had happened. Well, when our flight landed, we were in the terminal, and I finally caught up to him, and he had a big old grin on his face. And I told him I'd been looking for him and asked him what had happened. He said, that's when he smiled even bigger, and he said that the flight attendant had came up to him and asked if he wanted to move up to first class. And of course, Patrick naturally said, you know, I think I'll ask my boss, my head of staff, the senior pastor, if he would like to sit in first class, because he's old and could use the extra room. That's not what Patrick said. Patrick naturally said, of course I would like to sit in first class, and who wouldn't, right? I mean, given the choice, let's be honest, wouldn't any of us want the best seat possible? Whether it's on a plane or at a restaurant or a theater or in a ball game? You know, a few years ago, I went to see LeBron James play in Cleveland. Somebody gave me tickets as a gift for officiating their wedding, and they were really good tickets. We were 10th row, me and my two sons and my friend John Hartman, 10th row. And you better believe I wasn't looking to trade them with anybody way up high in the nosebleed seats. We all want the best seats possible. And in the ancient Near East, really, it's just the same today. A person's place at the table had special significance. In other words, you could pretty much tell who's who by where they sat. If you were somebody of note, you went straight to the head of the table. If not, you found yourself way down somewhere down the line, maybe at the kids' table. You remember the kids' table? Remember the excitement you felt the first time you got to go from the kids' table to where all the grown-ups were? Well, as everybody's elbowing their way to the grown-up table, they're jockeying around for the best seats in the house, Jesus clears his throat and he tells them a story. It's an illustration which challenges the conventional wisdom of the day. He says this, I want to share again. So if someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor. For a person more distinguished than you may have been invited, if so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, give this man your seat. Then, humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he will say to you, friend, move up to a better place. Then you will be honored in the presence of all your fellow guests, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Now, honestly, and be truthful about this, listening to this in a church setting where we all are friends and we'd all gladly give up our seats for one another, it really doesn't ruffle our feathers very much, doesn't it? It doesn't strike us as particularly radical. But it is, because once you go out these doors, What Jesus is saying makes about as much sense as, say, going to a ball game or a movie and intentionally choosing to sit in the worst place possible. Imagine saying, let's hurry up and get to the stadium so we can sit behind that pillar that blocks our view so well. Or to the theater where we can sit next to the noisy projector. That's not how it works. We expect to jockey and compete and elbow our way to significance. And it's so ingrained in us that we don't even consider any alternative. And I remember a few years ago, a guy near where I lived got to go on the TV show, Price is Right. You've probably seen The Price is Right. And he actually turned out to be the big winner that day. But in order to be the big winner, you've actually got to be selected as a contestant among the hundreds of other people who want to be contestants too. Well, this guy and his wife were in the audience when they heard the announcer call out. He said, Richard Cooper, come on down. You're the next contestant on The Price is Right. So Rick, as he's known, he jumped out of his seat, stumbled down the stairs, and he took his place on contestants row. And one winning bid later on a grandfather clock, he found himself standing on the stage next to the legendary Bob Barker. Well, Rick went on to win that day's Showcase Showdown, and he won over $18,000 worth of prizes. But you know, it wasn't just good luck smiling him on that day. It was also some clever self-promotion. See, Rick knew what that game was all about. He knew what the show was looking for in a contestant. He'd studied up. He's done his homework. And so he and his wife arrived at 4:30 in the morning to get a place at the head of the line. They wore matching bright red t-shirts with the name and the birth date of their son on them. And the name of their son, it was Price. So it made it kind of stand out. And all this caught the attention of the show screener, who interviewed Rick and his wife there in line. And by the time the show started, Rick said he had a feeling. He had a pretty good feeling he was going to be selected. And of course, he was, and the rest is history. And it's a neat story, of course. And Rick and his wife were smart for making themselves stand out that way. They knew how the game was played. But the point of Jesus' parable is to teach us that God's kingdom plays by a whole different set of rules. In other words, the values of the world are not the values of the kingdom. You see, in God's kingdom, self-promotion, self-assertion, putting yourselves out there ahead of everybody else, whatever you want to call it, that isn't the way. Instead, Jesus tells us that spiritual authenticity begins with humility. And biblically speaking, humility is simply about having a realistic assessment of ourselves and who we are. That's humility. You know, it reminds me, right about this time a year ago, I was really getting serious about losing weight. I've been wanting to lose weight for years. Everybody wants to drop a few pounds, right? And so did I. But it wasn't until I went to my doctor for a checkup and he said four words that woke me up and motivated me to get going. He looked at my chart and he said, he said, you've never been heavier. Wow. Right? I mean, it's like getting hit across the head with a 2x4. What do you do with that? I mean, either you admit it's true and do something about it, or you keep living in denial. And since I wanted to keep living, I had to be honest about my denial. But that's when things changed. That's when I got serious, when I understood my true condition. You've never been heavier. Well, the problem Jesus sees with everybody elbowing for the best seats in the house, you know, it's got nothing to do with social etiquette or where people are sitting. It's all about these attitudes that govern our hearts. You see, the reason we're always jockeying for position in life is because whether we realize it or not, we are always, always subtly measuring ourselves against everybody else. And therefore, the better my position relative to yours, the more worth I can convince myself that I have. But of course, this belies the whole issue, because in the end, the wrong comparison's being made. The issue is never, ever how we stack up against one another. The real issue, and what Jesus wants us to see, is how we stack up against an infinite and holy God. And in that comparison, we come up infinitely short. And it's no different when Jesus turns the story around and he speaks to the host. instead of the guests. And he reminds them that by inviting his rich friends and relatives, it's really not about loving his neighbor, it's really about loving himself, inviting important people to enhance his position so he looks important too, but it's the same issue. You see, jockeying for position, for recognition, for status and honor is what we do when we're stuck in the cycle of making the wrong comparisons. But Jesus shows us that we've turned it all around. In God's kingdom, everyone who exalts themselves will be humbled, while everybody who humbles themselves, understands their true condition, will be exalted. And the reason that's so is because only when we stop making the wrong comparisons between us and one another and begin making the right one between us and God are we then able to recognize our true condition, to understand our need, and to realize what we need to make us whole. In his book, Cure for the Common Life, Max Lucado tells of the great Protestant reformer Zwingli, who had a falling out with another great reformer, Martin Luther. And Zwingli felt convicted in his spirit about this dispute with Luther, but he didn't know what to do about it or how to effect reconciliation. And the story goes, one morning he found the answer to his problem on the side of a Swiss mountain. Zwingli was watching, apparently, as two goats were navigating a very narrow mountain path, each from the opposite direction. One goat was heading up the mountain, one goat was heading down. But at one point, the trail narrowed so much that it prevented either goat from passing each other. And so when the goats met, Zwingli said they each backed up a little bit and lowered their heads like they were getting ready to ram one another. But then an incredible thing happened. He said the goat heading up the mountain lay down on the path, while the goat heading down gently stepped over him. And then the one that lay down got back up and continued his climb back up the mountain. As Jesus says, everybody who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. In other words, just as Zwingli saw up on that mountain, only by going lower can we get higher. Only by understanding our true condition, not by comparing ourselves to others, but by comparing ourselves with God himself, understanding the depth of our sin, of human sin, in light of his holiness and grace. Only then are we in the right posture to receive what we really need. It is without a doubt the paradoxical nature of the kingdom that Jesus calls us to embrace, but here's the thing, it's something he embraced too. Paul says this in his letter to the Philippians. He says, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. In other words, Jesus himself took the lowest position possible, leaving heaven, coming to earth, embracing our sins on the cross, the Son of God dying for us as a man, so that men might become sons of God through him. So in the end, it's not a matter of where you sit. That's not what it's about. What Jesus wants us to understand, and what he gave his life to make possible, is that the best seat in the house is the one in which we realize our true condition before God, and where we recognize how far God was willing to go to redeem us through him. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior, who, Lord, just didn't tell us what to do, but showed us what to do. In the incarnation, his very life, his death, his resurrection. That, Lord, taking the lowest place possible, he became the perfect vehicle of salvation for all of humanity, the redemption of all creation, and is now exalted on high, Lord of heaven and earth. And so, Father God, we thank you, and we pray, Lord, that our attitudes would be likewise. That, Lord, we would have a true humility that, Lord, isn't about self-loathing, but about recognizing who we really are, Lord. And when we recognize our true condition, we can truly be healed. And so we pray for that, Lord, honest and even sometimes brutal self-assessment. And Father, we thank you. We pray for that, Lord, for our church, for our life in the church, our personal lives, our lives in society, Lord. Lord, and in a time now where it seems like fabrics of society are tearing apart, we pray for it even now, for an even greater, Lord, sense of who we are, Lord, and what we need to do to share the gospel of Christ in these times. And so help us, Lord, and thank you for your grace and your peace. And Lord Jesus, we pray in as much humility as we can at this moment that you would hear us now as we join together as one people praying the way you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Now, friends, I invite you to join with us for our concluding hymn today, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone.
Like me.
Amazing grace shown in Jesus Christ that allows us to be forever His. Friends, rest in that grace today, the grace that has bought you and redeemed you at great price and great love. And now, may the grace and peace of God our Father be with you, the joy and salvation of Jesus Christ around you, and the blessing of the Holy Spirit keep you today, this week, and forevermore. In Jesus' holy name, amen.